Okay, how's everybody doing out there? I'm gonna paint this Kahl Drogo piece here, and I'm using FW inks, which are basically these. I've got about five or six colors here: red, orange, blue, sepia, yellow, and a lighter shade of blue. And I might get some more at some point. Usually I work light to dark, doing the darks last. But in this case, I'm going to start with the darks first because his eyes are actually, you know, pretty dark. And since these acrylic inks can't be screwed with once they're dry, I can start with the darks, and if I paint over them, it's not going to affect them at all. So instead of using black or Payne's gray or something, I'm going to mix a little of this darker blue and this sepia together because it gives it a more interesting shade of black. You can maybe make it go a little blue or a little brown. Aside from the other essential items, the ink, the water, the brushes, I have my Dove chocolates. I need to have those. So if you hear me, you hear a little foil paper sounds, or suddenly I can't talk very well, it's because I got chocolate in my mouth. Okay. And normally I'd probably start with a bigger brush, but since I'm going to be painting these smaller areas, requiring a little bit more exact, tighter control, then I'm going to use this smaller brush, which is this big. So I added a little bit more sepia because it was looking a tiny bit too blue. And I'm going to use this brush sort of like a mall stick so your hand doesn't rest on the paper getting the oil from your hand on it. And I also realized when I did the drawing, I think this eye needs to be moved a tiny bit that way. So I'm probably going to try and do that. And it also needs to be a little closed a tiny bit more. So do that here. Right now we're listening to In Spiral Carpets. That's another thing that's essential in the painting process, is good working music. So I'm dipping the brush in the water so I can soften some of these areas, spread them out. And this mixture I'm using now, being a little bit more bluish and brownish, is actually pretty good because these what the hell is the race called? It'll come to me. But anyway, they have this sort of rouge that they wear on their eyes, and they're such badasses, no one's going to tell them that they're wearing makeup. Especially this guy, the baddest of the badasses. I was really sorry to see this character die. He's pretty entertaining. And also, I needed to make this brow a little bit more a little bit more downward tending, so it's a bit more angrier looking. So do that too while I'm doing this. And if I need to add a little bit more white to the eye, these inks are, or can be, pretty opaque, so I can do that a little bit later in the process. So what I'm going to do here for this little session of recording is try and get some of these dark areas done, and then I'll start a new little session so these films are not so long and don't take up so much memory and so much time to process. So there'll be more films than the last one I did, still covering the same amount of material. And I'll try to sort of establish the actual dark, pure dark areas, and then before the ink's totally dry, hopefully, I'll go in and with a little water and make any areas a little bit softer edged than they are now if they need to be. So that's what I'm going to do now. Get some water on the brush. See if I need to make any of these areas not quite so dark. Oh, now I got real old U2, the very first album. I bet a lot of you weren't even born when this came out. I'm so old. Okay, there are a few other areas. There's the hair, obviously, that I can maybe do. A few other things that are pretty dark, the nostril. I hear my daughter's feet. She's gonna come running in here, I'll bet. Nope, guess not. So I'm gonna add this dark area, and then I might come in and add some sepia areas here so that it's not just totally black but shows a little bit brown. Like right here, I think I'm going to add some sepia instead of the really dark color. My daughter does not know how to not slam a door, I guess. Alright, so I got a little sepia on the brush. Might look a little green. I want to get a little bit more sepia so this is not just close to black or blue in some of these areas. If I got a little bit too much paint or ink on the brush, I can dab it on my little scratch board that's sitting off to the side that I'm testing colors on as I go. A little bit more water, thin this out a little bit. I can always darken it up later. Hey, wake up. Don't fall asleep on me. So I'll go ahead, and this is sort of working from light to dark. In this case, adding sort of an underpainting of sepia for this beard that I'll go over with darker colors to add the darker areas, but I thought I'd at least get this established here. Usually, when I would start from dark to light on a face like this, I would usually probably start with the flesh tones with a bigger brush, laying them in kind of loose in the beginning. But since I'm sort of starting off the opposite this time, and since I'm using inks, which once they're dry, you won't mess them up, I can always go in and add that later unless I've already, you know, darkened the area. If the area is too dark, you'll have to go in and lighten it with some opaque passages of paint. And this little empty spot here is kind of important because it establishes that the beard is just hair down here. The chin comes around here and extends up into there, so you want to leave this little light spot. If you could see the photograph, you'd see what I'm saying. It shows the light shining through there, so you can see this chin isn't going way down here. Ooh, we're listening to Tom Waits now. In the cold, cold ground. Cold, cold ground. All right, I'm going to shut up now. What's going to be the fun part is once I'm done establishing some of these, I can go into the face and sort of loosely add a lot of the flesh tones. And especially in a face like this, where there's a lot of sort of grungy areas, you know, if this was, you know, a real well-tended female face, for example, a real beautiful woman's face, you probably wouldn't go in and add a lot of loose splotchy color, because it's not going to necessarily look that feminine and maintained. But this guy, obviously, the only makeup he uses is on his eyes, and so you can have those sort of splotchy areas. You'll see when I end up doing that part, which will be another separate little video from this. I'm going to just try and establish a lot of the darks in this one, and then I'll take a break. And I mean, I'm not going to take a break, but I'll stop the video and start it again. I'd sing along to Tom Waits, but I don't think you guys would appreciate that very much. So I just got a little paint and thinned it with a little water. I'm gonna go ahead and add this bluish, greenish, makeup-ish area in the eyes. So, I mean, you can see I'm sort of laying down the getting a lot of the basics. A lot of the basic shapes added in there, added in here early on, since I'm going from sort of from dark to light in this case. Get it off the brush, the water, so I can sort of soften the edges of some of these areas here. Okay, now we're listening to Robin Trower. Get rid of the paint, add some water. Well, some of these areas, obviously, I'll go and add some more flesh-tony colors. I'm just sort of establishing some darks. Now I think I'll get a bigger brush to do some of the hair here. So I'm sort of adding the darks here in the hair, and in a minute, once I get some of these real dark areas added, I'll go ahead and get the sepia and probably cover the whole area with sepia, because there aren't really very many areas that are lighter than that. And as a general rule that a lot of painters follow, that you should pretty much use the biggest brush you can get away with, so that it doesn't look like it's too careful and too controlled. Okay, I think I got some, well, actually, I guess I can do this ponytail part while I'm at it. Now, one thing I'm doing here, you can see the blue tape, the blue masking tape around the edges. When I did the first couple of Game of Thrones pieces a couple years ago, the very first one, I used this method, but since I laid down gesso on the drawing ahead of time, adding some texture to the board, the paint would end up seeping under the tape, which in most cases I wouldn't want. But what ended up happening is it seeped under the tape irregularly and created sort of a neat, very organic looking area around the outside. And I decided that looked pretty cool. So I just did the same thing with all the other ones after that. I'm doing the same thing here. I laid down blue tape, but I didn't really press super hard all the way around. I just pressed enough to keep it down and to know that there are some areas that are probably pressed down a little bit better than others, so there'll be some variety. It's not like it'll seep out everywhere. It'll seep out here and there and create a irregular pattern that is kind of neat. And I'm also going over some of these dark blue-gray areas with this sepia, so it sort of integrates it and doesn't look like one area of color next to another area of color, but integrates all of them together. I mean, if you want those dark areas dark, you're just going to maybe get them darker anyway, so this, you know, it still works. Now we're listening to great Loudon Wainwright III, Mr. Dead Skunk in the Middle of the Road. One of my big favorites. Okay, I think, except for these little, the bottom of the beard that have these little trinket areas hanging off, I'm almost done with the dark areas here. So I'll probably stop this video in a minute. Absorb it, Junior! Isn't that a fun little song? I'll probably darken these up a little bit more, even because they're looking a little green in some areas. And I don't know if I want that, but still a lot of time left to do all that sort of stuff.